world, the last chapter of a book and also of a life that you have read up to this point is the last work, cut short by death, of the author, Commander W.J.C. Carr, RCNRI, his oldest son, have tried to finish the work in order that it might be published to fulfill my father's last wish. I could not do so, and in all honesty, I do not believe it possible for any man, at this time, to do so either. The life work of one man can seldom be picked up and completed by another, particularly when the work covers the field dealt with in this book and in the books previously published by Commander Carr. I believe that he was a man gifted, or perhaps cursed, with the ability to see things that the rest of us cannot see or even conceive to be possible in our wildest imaginings. This ability to see clearly the workings and machinations that go on behind the scenes in all governments and many international organizations, and the ability to follow clearly the often dimly marked trail of evil that has crawled and slimed its way through the history of mankind, is given to few men. I believe that my father had this ability and that it died with him. For most of my early life, I watched doggedly tracing one lead after another to find the ultimate answer to the problem of evil in the affairs of men. At that time I was not really aware of what he sought or understood the terrible strain under which he worked. His searches were never easy on him or on those close to him, for he had all the human traits, both good and bad, that bless and plague the rest of us. He asked me several times, particularly after my discharge from the Canadian Army in August 1945, if I would work with him and eventually carry on the fight he felt was so important. I could not do so then and I cannot do so now for the reasons given above. At his death, he bequeathed to me his library, his manuscripts, and all his notes. He did not specify that I must try to carry on his work in order to qualify for this inheritance. I must confess that I rather spurned the idea of doing anything to further his efforts and even felt in a vague way that he was way off the beam in his writings. This manuscript was left in storage for about 6 years before I started to think of some of the things of which he had written and how accurately he seemed to be able to pinpoint certain future events in the affairs of men and of the world in which we live. I think it was particularly true at the time of the assassination of President Kennedy in 1963. If the author is anywhere near correct in his charges that the SOS pretty well controls all governments, it would be impossible for anyone to learn of the truth behind that murder. And I still cannot believe that the assassin's murder by Jack Ruby was not part of a prearranged plan to keep all details and information from the public view. I could be wrong. The author had an uncanny ability to pinpoint such events and even his own death. If you will reread chapter 3, page 41, he says that he seriously doubts that he will write any more books and at that time he was not any more seriously ill than at other times, and was only 62 years of age. With these thoughts, I reread the manuscript and became convinced that I had to do whatever I could to publish the information, incomplete though it was. How much you actually believe of what you read in this book is really of little importance. It would be too much to expect anyone to be able to assimilate such material in one bite. The exposure of such monstrous and inhuman plots verges on the impossible, and yet, down deep inside me, I know that such plots are in existence. The more I think about these matters, the more convinced I become, and this in spite of a natural disinclination to believe at all. This latter feeling I think will be a common one for the majority of readers. Even though this knowledge of the existence of a supernatural plot to destroy mankind has come to me, I do not particularly fear the plot in itself. I have always believed, in a general way, of the existence of evil and what evil tried to do with me and by me. But, By the grace of God, I also know that good exists and that by trying with all my strength to follow that good, automatically I relegate evil to its proper place on the fringe of my existence, in much the same way that cold is displaced by heat and mist burned away by a hot sun. I do believe now that evil exists and has been fostered and organized by men directed by the devil. But at the same time I believe even more strongly that God is and that Christ, as our closest and best example of good, also exists actively in the affairs of men. To me, the study of evil and its effect in the world is rather a negative approach to finding solution to the problems that have existed, do exist and will always exist, for all men, until the end of earthly time. Undoubtedly the knowledge of my Father's work and the reading of his many works have influenced my life greatly. Several years ago, when our children were self-supporting and no longer needed our direct help, my wife and I decided to dedicate several or all of our years to full-time work in the foreign mission field. I think this decision was taken, and is being followed, not so much to be do-gooders as for our own peace of mind and well-being. A long time ago I discovered that human happiness can best be found by giving of oneself in the service of others as long as the motive for that giving rests in the love of the God who created me. I think that the answer to the evil, as exposed and defined by my Father, is for every man and woman of goodwill to dedicate himself or herself to some phase of that human scene in such a way that the scene is improved by the effort expended. It really doesn't matter very much if the effect achieved is visible or measurable by the person or by his contemporaries, but rather that each man gives of his best to try and succeed. Page 86. Satan, prince of this world at this moment, the famous quotation of the late President Kennedy comes to mind, "Ask not what your country can do for you, but rather what you can do for your country." Substitute the words God, neighbors, religion, community, or whatever, for country, and we all have a working blueprint for our future efforts. To comment further on this work or on any particular phase of the Luciferian plot or the intrigues of the SOS would be to labor the point. To those who knew my Father personally or became interested in him through the reading of his books, perhaps a few words about his personal philosophies on life and living might prove of interest and give a clear insight into the mind of this remarkable man. From my earliest recollections of him, certain salient points of his character stand out boldly. He often told me that no man had the right to ask another to do or give what the asker was not willing to do or give first. I have talked to quite a number of naval men who served with or under Commander Carr in both World Wars, and they, to a man, confirmed that Dad had followed this thought to the point where he was known as the Iron Man in the sections in which he served in the Canadian Navy during the Second World War. Another point he stressed was that a man should work like hell while alive in order that he didn't end up in hell when dead. This book you have just finished reading is proof that he followed this dictate of conscience also, because he worked up to the limit of his strength and even beyond it into his final illness. During the hungry days of the Dirty Thirties, we lived in a small town just outside of Toronto, Ontario. Our house was on the main north-south highway of that time, and literally scores of hungry men begged for food at our door. Even though we were a large family and money was always scarce or non-existent, he never permitted a hungry man to be turned away without adequate food. His point was that if I refuse a hungry man some food, or cannot see in him some mark of Christ which makes him my brother, then I deny my own humanity. In the same way, no one hurt or in distress ever appealed for help from Dad and was turned away without a sincere effort to give the help needed. Many the widow and distressed ex-servicemen who came to him for help, and as a result, he gave uncounted days of work to win pensions or other relief for these unfortunates, either through the Canadian Legion or by himself working through the hundreds of contacts he made in high places as he went along with his work. No amount of money or proffered honors could win his support for a cause or an organization in which he did not believe fully, or which could not withstand his close scrutiny as to its reason for being. Because of his strong attitude in this respect, I know that he gave up many lucrative opportunities in order that he could, as he put it, shave myself in front of my own mirror. He was self-educated, self-confident, and self-opinionated. When the going got toughest, he refused to go to others for help until he had literally exhausted himself economically, physically, or mentally. He had a hair-trigger temper that threw him into terrible rages, and a soft heart that prevented him from holding that rage for more than a few minutes, or a grudge against even his worst enemy, and he made plenty of them as he went along. He could and did walk and talk with kings and those who occupy the high and mighty places of the earth, and he could and did sit in hovels and be completely at home in that setting. With those who opposed him, he was a hard, fair, and tough fighter, and he neither asked nor gave quarter. With the weak and the helpless, he had the tenderness of a good woman and a heart as soft and as sweet as melted butter. With his family and with himself, he was a hard and driving taskmaster. With others weaker than himself, he had an infinite capacity for pity and patience. For the last 15 years of his life, he suffered many illnesses and incapacities, not the least of which was a telescoped spine, which necessitated him wearing a cumbersome steel and leather brace to keep him from becoming badly deformed. I do not think that he ever considered these health problems anything more than a nuisance that handicapped his ability to follow the path of work which he had chosen for himself. Always his motto was, "Carry on." If ever an epitaph be written for him, let it be as follows: "He lived the hard life of a truly Christian man, and died the easy death reserved for such a one." If anything he ever wrote has helped even one person to find a purpose in life, or helped any individual to better understand the purpose and meaning of life, or helped one soul to regain its place in the divine scheme of things, then I am certain that his noble soul rests in peace within the love and protection of the God he tried so hard to serve while he lived his few years on earth. Page 87. Satan, Prince of this World, Appendix A. The Secret Covenant Against Humanity. The following contract first appeared anonymously on a website in June 2002. The origin is unknown, but is included here as further evidence of the claims made in Satan, Prince of this World. This was not originally included in the book. http://www.unveilingthem.com/secretcovenant.html. The Secret Covenant and Illusion. It will be so large, so vast, it will escape their perception. Those who will see it will be thought of as insane. We will create separate fronts to prevent them from seeing the connection between us. We will behave as if we are not connected to keep the illusion alive. Our goal will be accomplished one drop at a time, so as to never bring suspicion upon ourselves. This will also prevent them from seeing the changes as they occur. We will always stand above the relative field of their experience, for we know the secrets of the Absolute. We will work together always, and will remain bound by blood and secrecy. Death will come to he who speaks. We will keep their lifespan short and their minds weak while pretending to do the opposite. We will use our knowledge of science and technology in subtle ways so they will never see what is happening. We will use soft metals, aging accelerators, and sedatives in food and water, also in the air. They will be blanketed by poisons everywhere they turn. The soft metals will cause them to lose their minds. We will promise to find a cure from our many fronts, yet we will feed them more poison. The poisons will be absorbed through their skin and mouths. They will destroy their minds and reproductive systems. From all this, their children will be born dead, and we will conceal this information. The poisons will be hidden in everything that surrounds them, in what they drink, eat, breathe and wear. We must be ingenious in dispensing the poisons, for they can see far. We will teach them that the poisons are good, with fun images and musical tones. Those they look up to will help. We will enlist them too. Page 88. Satan, prince of this world, push our poisons. They will see our products being used in film and will grow accustomed to them and will never know their true effect. When they give birth, we will inject poisons into the blood of their children and convince them it's for their help. We will start early on, when their minds are young. We will target their children with what children love most, sweet things. When their teeth decay, we will fill them with metals that will kill their mind and steal their future. When their ability to learn has been affected, we will create medicine that will make them sicker and cause other diseases, for which we will create yet more medicine. We will render them docile and weak before us by our power. They will grow depressed, slow and obese, and when they come to us for help, we will give them more poison. We will focus their attention toward money and material goods so they many never connect with their inner self. We will distract them with fornication, external pleasures and games so they may never be one with the oneness of it all. Their minds will belong to us and they will do as we say. If they refuse, we shall find ways to implement mind-altering technology into their lives. We will use fear as our weapon. We will establish their governments and establish opposites within. We will own both sides. We will always hide our objective but carry out our plan. They will perform the labor for us and we shall prosper from their toil. Our families will never mix with theirs. Our blood must be pure always, for it is the way. We will make them kill each other when it suits us. We will keep them separated from the oneness by dogma and religion. We will control all aspects of their lives and tell them what to think and how. We will guide them kindly and gently, letting them think they are guiding themselves. We will foment animosity between them through our factions. When a light shall shine among them, we shall extinguish it by ridicule, or death, whichever suits us best. We will make them rip each other's hearts apart and kill their own children. Page 89. Satan, prince of this world, we will accomplish this by using hate as our ally, anger as our friend. The hate will blind them totally, and never shall they see that from their conflicts we emerge as their rulers. They will be busy killing each other. They will bathe in their own blood and kill their neighbors for as long as we see fit. We will benefit greatly from this, for they will not see us, for they cannot see us. We will continue to prosper from their wars and their deaths. We shall repeat this over and over until our ultimate goal is accomplished. We will continue to make them live in fear and anger, though images and sounds. We will use all the tools we have to accomplish this. The tools will be provided by their labor. We will make them hate themselves and their neighbors. We will always hide the divine truth from them, that we are all one. This they must never know. They must never know that color is an illusion. They must always think they are not equal. Drop by drop, drop by drop, we will advance our goal. We will take over their land, resources and wealth to exercise total control over them. We will deceive them into accepting laws that will steal the little freedom they will have. We will establish a money system that will imprison them forever, keeping them and their children in debt. When they shall band together, we shall accuse them of crimes and present a different story to the world, for we shall own all the media. We will use our media to control the flow of information and their sentiment in our favor. When they shall rise up against us, we will crush them like insects, for they are less than that. They will be helpless to do anything, for they will have no weapons. We will recruit some of their own to carry out our plans. We will promise them eternal life, but eternal life they will never have, for they are not of us. The recruits will be called initiates and will be indoctrinated to believe false rites of passage to higher realms. Members of these groups will think they are one with us, never knowing the truth. They must never learn this truth, for they will turn against us. Page 90. Satan, prince of this world, for their work they will be rewarded with earthly things and great titles, but never will they become immortal and join us. Never will they receive the light and travel the stars. They will never reach the higher realms, for the killing of their own kind will prevent passage to the realm of enlightenment. This they will never know. The truth will be hidden in their face, so close they will not be able to focus on it until it's too late. Oh yes, so grand the illusion of freedom will be, that they will never know they are our slaves. When all is in place, the reality we will have created for them will own them. This reality will be their prison. They will live in self-delusion. When our goal is accomplished, a new era of domination will begin. Their minds will be bound by their beliefs, the beliefs we have established from time immemorial. But if they ever find out they are our equal, we shall perish then. This they must never know. If they ever find out that together they can vanquish us, they will take action. They must never, ever find out what we have done, for if they do, we shall have no place to run, for it will be easy to see who we are once the veil has fallen. Our actions will have revealed who we are, and they will hunt us down, and no person shall give us shelter. This is the secret covenant by which we shall live the rest of our present and future lives, for this reality will transcend many generations and lifespans. This covenant is sealed by blood, our blood. We, the ones who from heaven to earth came. This covenant must never, ever be known to exist. It must never, ever be written or spoken of, for if it is, the consciousness it will spawn will release the fury of the Prime Creator upon us, and we shall be cast to the depths from whence we came and remain there until the end time of infinity itself. Page 91. Appendix B. Back cover. The symbol of Baphomet represents the powers of the darkness combined with the generative fertility of the goat. In its pure form, the pentagram, as shown on the front cover, is encompassing the figure of a man in the five points of the star, symbolizing man's spiritual nature. Satanism represents the carnal instincts of man, or the opposite of the spiritual nature. In Satanism, the pentagram is inverted to perfectly accommodate the head of the goat. Its horns represent duality and thrust upwards and effinace. The Hebraic figures encircling the symbol are found in the Kabbalah and spelled out Leviathan, which is the serpent of the watery abyss, and identified with Satan. From Hidden Secrets of the Eastern Star by Dr. Kathy Burns, page 92.